Hi folks, Mr. Ackerman here. Thanks for watching. The topic of this video is high dynamic range or HDR photography. I'm going to explain to you what exactly HDR means. I'm going to tell you how to shoot images that are ready to be HDR'd, as they say. In other words, I'm going to teach you what bracketing is, and I'm going to also show you how to make an HDR image in Photoshop. So let's get started. We're going to start by taking a look at a number of images that I found on the website 500px, which use the HDR technique, and I thought each had some quality that could help explain what this technique is. In this one, a photo of a town in Belgium, notice how the brightest regions, like the lightning here, have visible detail. Even in the clouds, you can see it. And the darkest regions, also up here in the clouds, or maybe in the shadows of this building, or in the river, also have detail. There's a wide range of brightnesses that have detail. If you want to know who this photographer is, here he is. You can check him out on 500px. Here's another image, which I found. Notice how this is a daytime landscape photo, which is kind of rare. We usually shoot these at sunrise or sunset when the lighting is more even and balanced and soft. Midday sunlight tends to create a lot of harsh shadows. But this guy's photographed this scene in Arizona where you can actually see bright detail in the clouds, the highlights are there, and deep shadow regions like these canyons that would normally be looking pretty dark in a photo in daytime, they also have detail in the rocks. This is also an HDR image, and the photographer, his information is right here. Finally, here's an image of a sunset in Istanbul, Turkey. Bright sky sunset and dark shadow regions like over here on this side of the boat all have detail. There's a wide range of brightnesses with visible information. And here is the photographer info for this guy. So all of these photos are images that have a high dynamic range, a wide range of brightnesses with visible detail, and it's partly because of the way they were shot, partly because of the way they were processed. So what I did to help explain this was I went around into Photoshop, into the school rather, and I took an image which I'm going to open in Photoshop, and I'm going to show you what the challenge was for me in terms of dealing with brightness, and then how I ultimately dealt with it using HDR and a technique called bracketing. So first of all, I'm going to open this image, but not through the open command, but through Browse in Bridge. Check this out. Bridge is a separate program that Photoshop comes with, and it allows you to look at all your images along with the image information in a handy little screen like this. So you navigate to where your images are on your computer like you normally would, and you find your image. Here it is. It's the Willowbrook stairwell, and if you click on one image, you get all your image data here. F11, ISO 400, 1/400th of a second. And if you move this slider, the image gets bigger and you get to see what's going on. So I chose this region not because of its beauty, but because it has a really bright area, the window, and really dark areas, the stairwell. So it's a candidate for HDR imaging. I'm going to double click on this to open it in Photoshop. And while I do that, I want you to think about how you would edit this if you really needed to sort of get some detail out of the dark regions here. If you said, well, I would add a brightness contrast layer and I would brighten it up, and then I would go to the layer mask, select a black color, get a paintbrush going with a decent size relative to the window, and then I would just paint black on the layer mask, then you're right. This is the way we normally deal with this. We do a local adjustment to brightness and contrast, and this isn't a great job, it just gives you a rough idea. On off, see what I've done? I've brightened everything except the window. I've masked out the window, and maybe this is okay for our purposes. You'd say, hey look, now everything's a little bit more balanced, it's kind of more like what it looks like, it's great. Well, there's another thing that you can do, and it's called shooting a bracket of images and then using the HDR command in Photoshop to give you better results. But before we do that, just quickly, a little note on how your eye works. If you were actually standing here, you wouldn't see something like this. I'll show you what you would see. I'll go back to Bridge and just make this a little bit smaller so we can see more than one image at a time. Here's two images I took. This is the one we just opened, but over here is a much brighter image. Look at the image information. This one here, F11 ISO 400. This one here, F11 ISO 400. Those are the same. The difference is the shutter speed. 1 over 25, pretty slow. 1 over 400, pretty fast. By having a slower shutter here, I let in more light, and as a result, I was able to see the shadow regions. This is actually what the shadows would look like if you stood there and you were walking down the stairs trying not to trip. It would not look like this. But that's because your eye is controlled by your brain, and your brain does things that you don't even know half the time. What your brain does when you look in a dark area is it makes your eye open up. It makes the pupil open up to let in more light. So if you look down here, you see it brightly. If you could look here and here at the same time and make your eyes adjust to this, the window would look really bright. Or conversely, if you looked out the window here, your eyes, the pupils would get really small so that you could manage the brightness, but you wouldn't be able to see anything here because your eye can't do two things at once. Fortunately, your brain knows where you're looking and it adjusts accordingly so you can see what you're doing. The camera can't do this. It's got one setting that you see here, and you either expose for the highlights or the shadows, but not both. In HDR, we try to do both, and we do it by shooting multiple images. So let me show you what I mean. I realized I couldn't accommodate all the brightnesses in the image when I was standing there with just one photo, so here's what I did. I shot a sequence of photos. This one here was my best guess about what looked good. I'll zoom in. And you can see I did an okay job on the shadow regions, but not a very good job on the bright highlight regions. So I sped up my shutter just a bit to make a darker image that showed the window a little bit better. And look at what's going to happen here. Aperture and ISO are going to stay the same, but I'm going to go from a 50th of a second to a 100th of a second, 2 times faster, which in photography, when you multiply by 2, it's called a stop, 1 stop darker. And then I did it again. The window's starting to come into view now, because now I'm at 200, 1 over 200 of a second, 2 times less light, 2 times faster shutter speed, a stop darker. And I did it even again. I'm at 1 over 400. That allowed me to accommodate the brightness of the window, but I sacrificed the shadow regions. So I had to take more photos. I had to go brighter than the original photo. It used to be, the original photo was 1 over 50, now there's 1 over 25. Again, 25 times 2 is 50. There's that factor of 2. But this time, longer shutter speeds. Half of 25 is 12 and a half. Your camera rounds that to 13. There's 1 over 13 of a second. And half of 13 is 6 and a half. Your camera rounds that to 6. There's the last image. So all of these 7 images I just talked to you about are what we call brackets. There's your best guess, and then 1 stop darker, 2 stops darker, 3 stops darker. And then 1 stop brighter, 2 stops brighter, 3 stops brighter. The photos of my hand here are not an accident. They tell me where the beginning and end of the sequence is. If you don't do this and you bracket, then get ready for a lot of hassle trying to figure out what is the beginning and end of a bracket sequence. But if you just take a picture of your hand or something, you'll know the beginning and end. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to open these in Photoshop by going File, Automate, Merge to HDR Pro. Browse and find those images. So I'm already in the folder. There's a test shot, test shot, test shot, test shot. Beginning of sequence. So first real images here, there, 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 okay. And end of sequence. So from there to here, shift click, open, make sure this button is checked, and click OK and let Photoshop do its thing. It's going to combine all of these images into one. Now while it's doing that, let me just review with you some of the things you need to do for successful bracketing. First of all, set up on a tripod so that your camera doesn't move from image to image. This will help Photoshop align the images. Remember to start with your average or best guess of an exposure. Focus manually and don't change the focus once you start shooting. Also, I recommend you use the timer function on your camera so that you don't bump the camera when you press the button and therefore affect the clarity of your photo. Next up, shoot an image that's one stop darker by speeding up the shutter by a factor of 2. And then do it again. Speed up the shutter again by a factor of 2 to get an even darker image. Then do the reverse. Make your image brighter by slowing the shutter, making a longer shutter 2 times, and then again 2 times. So in the end of this sequence, you'll have your original image, 1 and 2 stops darker, 1 and 2 stops brighter. In my example in Bridge, I went 3 stops brighter and 3 stops darker for a total of 7 images, but I'm sure you'll be fine with this. Now let's go back to Photoshop and see what it did for us. You see we're in this window called Merge to HDR Pro. The 7 images used are shown here. EV is exposure value 0. This is the middle image, the average, my best guess. -1 is 1 stop darker. -2 is 2 stops darker. 3 stops darker. And then +1, 2, and 3 are brighter images. Now over here, these sliders here are to adjust brightness of the shadow and highlight regions, and also to adjust the color. You can do this all in regular Photoshop, so I think you should not touch these. This thing called Edge Glow, I have to admit, I'm not a huge user of HDR, and I don't really know what they mean. All I know is if you move them, things change. So watch what happens if we go for radius higher. You can notice a change in the image there. I don't know if you like the change. I don't really, so I'm just going to go back to here. For strength, if you go over to here, things get really weird and you get these weird ghosting effects pretty quickly. So I'm going to ease off on that. But some people do like this effect. For some people, it gives kind of a, you know, like you see this in the movies sometimes, sort of a surreal look to the photo. It also tends to bring out some texture. So whether you want to do this or not is up to you. Here's a combination of radius and strength. But again, I'm more of a naturalist in that sense. I like to keep things the way they were naturally, so I don't really touch that. Gamma and exposure are also brightness things. I would leave them. You can fix them in regular Photoshop. But detail, if you increase that, you get more of that texture, which again, kind of makes me think of a movie that's been shot in a surrealistic kind of way. You might like that. Suppose we like things this way, let's click OK and have it open up in Photoshop. So here you go. Here is our image ready to be treated like a regular image, only we're starting from a point that is much better than what we had. Are you ready for it? Back here. Remember this one? Looks awful now by comparison. Here was the original image. The shadows are completely crushed and the highlight region is acceptable. Altogether, the image looks blah. And try to fix it using a brightness contrast layer and local adjustments, good luck. You just don't have the dynamic range that we have in this image. Now, you might also complain that this image lacks some contrast, and you're right. So let's do what we always do, levels. Let's bring in that black point slider and work on our shadows there. You can play around with the white slider, but I'm already losing detail out the window, so I'm not even going to touch that. Next up, I might do a curves adjustment. I can play around with brightening up the midtones, or maybe putting a little bit of an S-curve in there. Let's see how that looks. That adds a bit of contrast, it's okay. Anyway, here's a neat thing to do. Control-click to highlight any of the layers that you have. Control-G to group them and to quickly be able to see on and off, do I like what I did? Let's say you do like what you did and you got that. We're comparing it to this. Whether you're a big fan of HDR or not, I think you can agree that this is nowhere near as good or as realistic as that. And there are definitely things I can do to improve this. I'm going to leave that to you because I don't want to make this video any longer than it has to be. But that's the basic idea for HDR. The rest is up to you to find the scenes, to shoot them carefully with bracketing, to bring them into Photoshop, to move those sliders in the HDR window, and then again with layers in regular Photoshop. And in the end, hopefully you have images that might begin to approach what we saw in the very beginning, where there were great dynamic ranges and you really made things look a bit more realistic. All right, folks, thanks for watching and have a great day.